figure, we want to look at tubuloglomerular feedback. And what that means is the nephron feeds back to the glomerulus in the aid of regulation of GFR. Now, this is going to occur through both autoregulatory and hormonal mechanisms. Now, at the upper right here, we have a blow-up of an entire nephron leading into its collecting duct over here on the left. And the region blown up here on the left is this right here. We have the renal corpuscle with the glomerular capillaries inside. We have an afferent and efferent arterioles supplying those glomerular capillaries. And then we have, importantly, we have the returning loop of Henle, the ascending loop of Henle, passes through this vascular pole right here to generate these cells known as maculodensis cells. Those are the cells that help the distal nephron tell the very beginning of the system what's going on and to aid in the regulation of GFR. And so let's look over here. Now we have these maculodensis cells blown up, and these are going to be the cells that are sensing what's happening in that late nephron to help control GFR. Now let's look at an initial perturbation. Let's have a low perfusion pressure, a fall in blood pressure, hypotension. And that's going to lead to a fall in our blood hydrostatic pressure in these glomerular capillaries. If you recall, PC, this blood hydrostatic pressure, is the driving pressure for filtration at the glomerulus. And so if PC falls, GFR is going to fall. We need that to not occur. So now, once that PC falls and GFR falls, the flow rate along this nephron is going to go down. Now, the tubular transporters have essentially a fixed rate of function. And so that slower flow is going to allow for enhanced reabsorption of solute, especially sodium and chloride, along the ascending limb of Henle here, right? So we're going to bring more sodium and chloride out, reducing the osmolarity in the maculodensis cells here, right, where we pass through that vascular pole. And here we have that effect. We have low sodium and chloride due to this fall in GFR and the associated fall in nephron flow rate. That's going to generate a maculodensis signal that's going to tell the afferent arterial smooth muscle to dilate. That dilation will allow the upstream pressure to travel more downstream, to enhance that downstream pressure, bringing PC up and bringing GFR back up, helping to autoregulate GFR through this tubuloglomerular feedback mechanism. Now, in addition to that mechanism, this low sodium and chloride in the maculodensa will also stimulate the production of renin. Renin is an enzyme secreted by these juxtaglomerular cells. These are cells in the wall of the afferent arteriole. And those cells produce this renin, which will lead to the production of the hormone angiotensin II. Now, in addition to that signal from the maculodensa, this renin enzyme is also stimulated in response to low blood pressure in these afferent arterioles. So essentially, the afferent arterioles are a baroreceptor. And so low pressure leads to increase in renin secretion. The renin secretion will eventually lead to the production of angiotensin II. And what we find is that the angiotensin II is actually going to act largely on the efferent vessel and cause constriction. This will also enhance the PC. This is creating back pressure in these glomerular capillaries. This also brings our PC up, bringing our GFR back up to normal. Now, finally, angiotensin II also causes systemic constriction, constriction of arterioles throughout the body. And if you recall, blood pressure equals cardiac output times total peripheral resistance. And so our angiotensin II is going to constrict our blood vessels, right, our arterioles. That's going to increase this resistance, which is going to increase our blood pressure, which is going to solve part of our initial problem here, the fact that we had a low driving pressure initially. And so overall, we're resolving our low blood pressure issue, but we're also helping maintain our GFR, even if that blood pressure remains low.